It's Warren Huart here. Hope you're doing marvellously well. I'm with my very old friend. Well, you're not old, but I've known you for a long time.
Getting there.
Mr. Phil Allen, how are you, mate?
Doing great.
That was a nice firm handshake. Ow! Ow! So we are here in Wither. I've got to get this right because I have...
With the accent.
I have absolutely no idea how to pronounce Spanish words properly. Sorry, all Spanish viewers, Spanish-speaking viewers. Los Rios. Is that good?
Close enough.
Close enough.
Yeah.
Rock school.
Yeah.
Not School of Rock, but Rock School.
Yeah.
Marvelous.
In beautiful San Juan Capistrano, where I grew up.
Did you grow up here or in San Clemente?
I grew up here in San Juan Capistrano.
Oh.
Yeah.
Why would I always think San Clemente?
Because no one knows where San Juan Capistrano is, so everyone from here says, oh, I'm from San Clemente.
Oh, yeah, I see.
Next town over. Yeah.
Right. Well, I didn't really grow up here, so I know about as much as for either of the towns. But this is like... It's a beautiful place. This is the first time I've been here, but obviously you've been here many times.
Yeah.
We've had fun because we're tracking a song from scratch with an artist called Morgan Mallory.
That is correct.
That's correct.
Mm-hmm.
So you're doing like a full production on it. What did you play on it?
I played bass and some acoustic guitar on it. It was a song that Morgan showed me a couple days ago.
Sure.
Went over to his house, did a little bit of pre-production, just ironing some stuff out.
Great.
He had a couple chorus ideas. So essentially, I just kind of tell him what I like. And he trusts me. We did an album together. So that's nice.
Right.
That he just takes my word for it. It's a little bit of pre-production. And then we had some really, really, really talented musicians come in. Ryan Smith.
And Justin.
Norman. Yeah, and Justin. Yeah. Ryan Smith and Justin Norman, who with these two guys, I'm part of a kind of production team and session band called The Hit Storm. But really talented dudes. Morgan is an incredible singer, which makes my job so easy.
Yeah, the bridge in this song is very special.
He's one of those guys who can sing anything and make it sound great. So makes me look really good because I just essentially plug in a mic and then tell him to go for it. But yeah, it's a great song. He's an amazing songwriter. He's very open to kind of letting the song go different directions, which as a producer, we know is very helpful.
Absolutely.
And I have to fight people at every turn.
Sure.
So it was fun. It was fun to watch it all, especially in the course of one day, go from just a little, iPhone recording of acoustic guitar and vocal.
Great.
And have these guys come in and, put their spin on it and then to build it straight up. But yeah, it's a little fun little process.
Wonderful. So now I've known you since you were...
19, 18? Yeah. 19, I think, yeah.
19, and you interned at my old studio.
Yeah, at Swing House, yeah, when I was in college.
That's crazy. And you went to USC.
Mm-hmm, did the music industry program there, yeah.
Which I think is the best results I've had with degree courses are USC and IU.
Yeah, the USC course is really awesome. It's constantly changing. It's very different now than even when I went there, but they're very real world.
Yeah.
It's definitely not... Come in here and we're going to promise you all this stuff. And it's,
sure.
they tell you right when you walk in, you're going to learn more in 3 months at an internship than you will at the 4 years here.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, they tell you that straight up. But they tell you when you get that internship, by doing this program, you're going to have an edge over everyone else. And being such a competitive industry, it's great to have that edge.
Well, Barrett, seeing as you actually interned with me, was that true?
Oh, I don't know. I think my edge was the ability to withstand hot weather. On the first day of interning at the Summer Strummer concert, I think by 2 o'clock, everyone else had passed out, and I was still going. I just knew to prehydrate. It was about 110 degrees.
It was about 100 degrees, for real.
Yeah, and I was the only person, I think, there who didn't smoke, which meant I was the only person who was, after a few hours, still able to carry heavy speakers from the stage to the truck where everyone else had pretty much given up. So that was my edge on that day. Yeah.
That was crazy. Yeah, setting up, breaking. Were we breaking down or setting up the festival?
Both. Yeah.
Oh.
I remember being there for both. Yeah.
Hey. Hey. That really is a baptism of fire.
Yeah, that sucked. I'm not going to lie. That really sucked.
Yeah, and you still came back.
Yeah, which was a miracle. Yeah. But it was
you were on the cusp, yeah.
I was really rethinking my life at that point. Around about 4 o'clock on my first day of interning. Yeah. But we stuck with it.
And then you interned at Epic.
Yeah, in the A&R department. Yeah. Which was definitely not my cup of tea, but I'm glad I did it to learn that it was not my cup of tea.
Right.
Yeah. It was that I am not a businessman at all.
And then from Epic, you went to, you can tell I know him well because I know his career. It's amazing. And then from Epic, you went, after you finished USC, your first job was actually at Blue Microphones.
It was, yeah. That was a weird one. I actually, when I was at school, I remember spending a little while going like, oh my God, I have to get a job after I graduate. So I just sent my resume to like 30 different companies that I liked. Like, oh, I like that product, sent my resume. And I think they called me back about a year and a half later and said, hey, we got your resume a little while ago. We have a job opening. And thank God it just coincided right when I graduated.
Perfect.
So yeah, I worked there for a little while. I was building microphones, which was really fun, actually. I love the tinkering part of it. Right. And I learned so much about microphones there, which ended up being very useful later on.
Right.
Just knowing the ins and outs of them and to some point being able to fix them when they broke. So there's a couple moments where I
looked. Which reminds me, I have a few back at the studio.
Yeah, I know a guy.
If you can check it out. And you microphones, we also built that preamp that we used.
Yes, lot. Yeah. Mics and preamps. They have one preamp, so I built, you know, would assemble those. And, you know, it was good to kind of get inside of the gear for a bit, as opposed to just knowing how to twist the knobs, actually opening it up and seeing what's going on. And it does help you, as techy as that stuff is, it helps you with the creative process. Because, as you know, the more you know about the tech stuff, it's not to be techie is the point. It's sure. to make the creative thing more efficient. If you're not sitting there, if you have a great idea, but something doesn't work, to be able to fix that quickly or to troubleshoot it or get around it, isn't the point to show off your creative knowledge or your technical knowledge. It's to
sure.
keep the song going.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree 100%. I've been saying this a lot recently because I think it seems to be something I'm realizing more and more is like, we need to know the technical inside and out so that we don't have to rely on it.
Yeah.
That it's just second nature. I always tell people, just know your DAW, be an amazing editor, and don't be like, I'm a great editor. It's like, yeah, you have to be a great editor.
Right.
And so you that know, you don't have to edit.
Yeah, and we've seen so many people run Pro Tools, and Pro Tools is such a complex program, and it's so unique in its way that you might run into someone who uses it entirely different than you use it. You've probably sat down at a Pro Tools mm-hmm. rig that someone else was using and nothing worked because all their buttons are different. They don't have, you know, key command focus or whatever. They use a trackball, just so many little things. And you feel like you're starting over. You're just
I can't even move
this track. But it's just one of those things where you do it the way you do it and there's no right or wrong way. It's all it really comes down to is can you get the final result sounding?
Absolutely.
That's all we really care about.
Yeah, I think I've told every assistant intern that's ever worked for me is like, as long as the results are really good, I don't really care how you got there.
Yeah.
And in the studio, it's all about the what's the least dramatic way of getting from A to B.
Yeah.
You know, just like, oh, if something's going wrong, I don't need to know. If I'm the producer, like, we'll figure it out.
Yeah, don't slam the brakes on the session just because something's going wrong.
Yeah.
If you can just take care of it in the background or
it's
about the end result, not the way you get there. We have so many rules that we follow, especially with editing and stuff like that, but you can follow all the rules and still really screw it up.
Yeah.
And so ultimately, you know, at the end, does it sound good? Great. I don't care how you got there. Sometimes I really don't want to know how you got there actually.
No, nor do I. I mean, yeah, sometimes you just sort of throw it into elastic pitch and kind of make it all kind of work.
Yeah, I break all my rules all the time. Stuff I say I never do. I do it. Just don't tell anyone that I do.
No. I don't do that. Yeah. No, everything's done on tape.
I never copy the same chords over twice, ever.
Yeah.
Oh, except for those 1,000 times that I've done it.
Yeah. Yeah. Whatever works is what works.
Because it sounded better. Yeah.
Because it sounded better. Yeah, definitely. So, Blue Microphones. Mm-hmm. And then I remember somebody had told me about this little studio that was for rent and the guy wanted to sell the equipment with the studio.
Mm-hmm.
So I went to go and check it out and it was like in Santa Monica,
mm-hmm.
not in Santa Monica, on Santa Monica Boulevard.
Correct, yeah, in West Hollywood. Yeah.
Good old West Hollywood.
Mm-hmm.
And I went in there and it's just like, it's like a little converted house, isn't it?
That's kind of overselling it. It's a converted bungalow, really.
Right.
Yeah, it was tiny. Yeah.
And so went there, and they had at that time they had a grand piano, a Steinway, a little control room, like a triangular shaped control
room.
Very
oddly shaped.
Yeah. Very oddly shaped.
It reminded me of one of those rooms in Willy Wonka that just kept getting smaller as you went in. It just kind of went to a point. It was very strange. Yeah.
Actually, I remember the thing that I was most excited about was all the tube tech stuff.
Uh-huh.
I remember going, whoa, cool, tube tech, you know. And so the guy had bought the gear off of the previous owner,
right,
but was renting the property and needed to get out because I think he moved to Hawaii, actually, didn't he? He moved to Hawaii.
Sounds about right, yeah.
And ran that show that he was doing. Mm-hmm. So we went back to our mutual friend at Epic and told him about it, and Epic actually picked up the studio, mm-hmm. and you became the studio manager. And
I got the phone call of, hey, I want you to come check out this studio. Mm-hmm. Went and checked it out. And at the time, I was just excited to get back into recording, really. Would have loved to get into that. So I said, yeah. And to be honest, I was probably a little overzealous, but it was a good move for me. Essentially just got handed the keys to this place. And the don't burn it down kind of.
I remember Kiara had said, oh yeah, Phil really wants to do that. And I'd worked with you, but I didn't know your Pro Tools level and all this kind of stuff. Yeah. And I said to her, this is Kiara and just how she is. I was like, well, you know, can you do this and can you do that? And she called, looked at me and I asked her like 8 questions in a row. And she's like, he can do anything.
Just like money for that.
Yeah. Just like he can do anything. Just like fat, like you know how just stared right straight in the face. Like I was like, okay, not gonna fight for Kiara on that one. The reason why this is an important part of the story is so it became like initially sort of Epic's writing production. I made records in there. I think I made 2 or 3 albums that you worked on with me, and with Epic. But then it sort of became, as well as that, when we weren't making records in there, like writer-producer room, and guys would come in, like Fraser T, mm-hmm. and of course Dan Wilson, and everybody.
Yeah, it started out, I think Epic's idea was to have a room that they could write in and maybe do some production in that they didn't necessarily have to book out and pay for all the time. Like if they wanted a writing session that was going to last 12 hours, that they didn't have to pay someone for that. Sure. And just to have their own place where if they needed someone to edit files, they didn't have to outsource it to another studio or something like that. Right. So, yeah, initially it was a lot of writing sessions and some editing jobs of just Epic artists, a lot of new Epic artists, kind of the unheard of fresh signees. But then, yeah, over time, I think a lot of people came in, a lot of the writers would come in with these Epic artists, and they loved the room. As weird and small as it was, there's something really unique and quirky about it. It was very, as soon as you walked in there, you forgot you were in West Hollywood, which was a blessing. So what ended up happening was they started calling and saying, like, the writers would say, hey, I'm supposed to do the session with blah, 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 not on Epic. Can I just book out the room? And we just said, sure, why not? And it just kind of snowballed from there, and people started loving it. Plus, the piano in there was gorgeous. So,
yeah, the Yamaha. We got rid of the Steinway. Yeah, the original owner took it back, which was a beautiful piano. It was a B, wasn't it? It was like a 1927 Steinway B.
Very warm and dark sounding. Yeah. It was beautiful, yeah.
But then, Flynn put in the C7.
Yeah, which was
just a great,
amazing,
a great pop piano. And I don't mean that to diminish it. Pop makes it sound like it wasn't great. No, it's the C7 is one of the finest kind of pop pianos, and
it's very recordable.
I was about to say very recordable. And the great thing about a C7 is you can put a little bit of lo-fi plug in there, a bit of saturation. It goes one way.
Yeah.
You can sparkle and clean and brighten it. You can do all kinds of stuff with a C7.
Totally, yeah.
I mean, it's really incredible sounding piano. So this leads us on to, so you're saying producers bring in other artists. So Adele comes in and does some recording.
Yeah, she, I think it was through Dan Wilson first. He was in there, I believe he had written with Dave Gibson. And that's how he heard about
Dave Gibson!
Yeah, the first session I ever did.
Dave Gibson.
Yeah. And so Dan wrote with him, and then he liked the studio, loved the piano.
Right.
And so he started, he was still living in Minnesota at the time, I think. So whenever he'd come out to LA, I think he just, that was one of the spots.
Had you already written Ready to...
To Make Nice?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think he'd already...
So he'd already written
he'd already done that, yeah. So, you know, he's this successful songwriter.
Dixie Chicks.
Yeah. And he liked the room, liked the piano. It's very his speed. Mm-hmm. He's a, like, very mellow guy. And so, yeah, he had a writing session with Adele. And so they came in and wrote, the first day they were in there, they wrote Someone Like You.
So they write, so basically there's a pair of 87s on the piano.
Correct, yep.
She's in the little vocal booth on the U48.
Emphasis on the little vocal booth,
very
tiny little closet, yeah.
Kind of little closet. And she did what, a live vocal with the piano?
I'm sure she did sing along with the piano. But it was kind of one of those days of writing a little bit, recording a little bit, writing a little bit, recording a little bit. And then kind of at the end of the day, one of those things like, okay, we got to get this down. start to finish to send to the label. She's in the process of writing her stuff. So I think Dan did probably a one take piano with a punch in or two, and same kind of thing with a vocal. I'm sure she sang. Oh, I got to go back and mess that part up. Punch in, but really the whole point of it was just to get it down, kind of thing.
So how many vocals do you think?
I mean, it was maybe two or three punches throughout the whole take.
So it's a take with a couple of punches.
Yeah, and then they wrote the bridge on day two. So we did first chorus, and then she wanted to go work on the bridge, came back, and we cut in. I think we cut in the bridge.
It's like into the piano part as well?
I think so, yeah. I mean, my memory is terrible. But one thing I will take away, well, many things I will take away from that session.
Obviously.
But God bless Dan Wilson. The one thing I really learned from him was he kind of always likes to get things right. In a weird way, he's very kind of loose and like, oh, let's just see where this goes. But at the same time, you do it right, which is nice. And we spent a little bit of time, I remember, programming the click to that song. It is not one tempo all the way through. And a lot of people don't even think it's done to a click, because if you were to line it up to a click, it eventually gets off. Yeah. So I think a lot of people think it's just like a live free thing. Right. But he was very meticulous about, okay, it needs to come up 2 BPM here. And so we sat there and programmed it, and in the slow down before the last chorus, we programmed a little sloping click, and he's very, very in tune to that kind of stuff. And it was kind of one of those things where I'm like, I usually don't do this, but this is kind of neat.
Tempo mapping made
a big difference. Yeah, tempo mapping.
We did it on a demo with Iris.
Oh, yeah?
So, yeah, so that same mentality.
Yeah, like it needs to be right. Like, we're not just going to wing it, and we're not going to do one tempo just because that's what everyone does. He felt it moving, so we took a little time to do that, and thank God he did, because the demo that we recorded there turned out amazing. It feels really good. Yeah.
So you do the demo. Mm-hmm. Then she goes off into the sunset. Mm-hmm. And I remember like, it was like almost like a 3-stage story. You're like, where was I? Was I already starting Aerosmith, or was it already happened by then?
I think it already happened by then. It was before.
So I was doing another record, and I'm speaking to you. I don't know what record I'm doing. And you said to me, oh, it's really funny. It seems like they're going to use the demo on the record.
And you're like, I got the call from her manager. Hey, man, just want to let you know, like, someone like you is going on the record. Oh, man, that's cool. And like, no, sorry. The one that you guys did is going on the record. I was like, oh, I thought she re-recorded that. No, she did. But she really loved the demo. And really what it came down to is she loved the vocal on the demo. Because it is, right. I mean, we've all heard it. It's great.
Wasn't the story that a mother loved the demo so much it made her cry?
That's what I heard, yeah. I mean, again, I'm so far removed from the actual stories, who knows? But I heard that, yeah, her mom reacted a lot better to the demo than the other one. Who knows if that's true or not.
Yeah.
I'd like to believe that it is.
I heard the same thing at the time. And that makes sense, because the song's pretty pertinent, because she was fresh out of a breakup.
And... Yeah, and I think that had a big part of it is the difference between singing the emotion and singing the
when it just happened, then a year later, yeah.
Yeah, so they told me that, it's going on there, and I remember my first thought being like, oh, God, I hope I did well on that. Like, because at the time, it was just a demo, so, you know, I can hear the mistakes in it, but I don't know if anyone else can. I'm sure someone can.
Right.
On my end, from the recording standpoint. But, yeah, they just threw it on there like that. They didn't add anything to it, and, you know, it was mixed beautifully, thank God. Went on the end of the record. I remember kind of thinking, that's kind of neat that, you know, one, the demo made it on, but two, that like she could say, like, I want the demo on there. And they said, all right, that's because we both know working with labels how quickly they can just say, nope.
Right.
We're putting the one we want on there. And, you know, it's a fight that happens all the time. So they said yes, and it went on there. And it was just one of those moments that was, oh, that's kind of cool. And I remember talking to the manager and, you know, is it going to be a single? Nah, probably not. It's just a vocal piano. It's not going to be a single.
And then...
Whatever. And then she sang it on the Brit Awards?
Brit Awards.
And they called me the next day and said, hey, man, turns out it's a single. And it was like the fastest selling something on iTunes.
Because they basically, their hand was forced, or whatever the phrase is, because she sings it on the Brit Awards. And people, real live people, bought the song.
Yeah. What a shocker.
They went to the album and went, what was that great song I heard on the Brit Awards? Oh, there it is, Bye Bye Bye.
Yeah.
And it's suddenly in the top 5 or something immediately afterwards.
And I remember talking to him on the phone and saying, that's really awesome. Is it going to get released in the U.S. as a single?
No.
No way. U.S., you kidding me?
Yeah, piano vocal, that'll never be a hit.
Not putting a piano vocal. And then I think she sang it on an award show here, and same story. They just, it blew up. Good song's a good song, you know.
Number one in 13 countries or something
like that. That's crazy,
So that's like, there's one and two of the story.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, they do the demo, then it becomes the record.
Mm-hmm.
Then it becomes the single. And then number three, you're like, you call me up and you go, so apparently it's like nominated for a Grammy or something?
So I'm told. So yeah, that was kind of neat. And it's such a strange thing. I mean, the way the Grammys work and who gets nominated as engineers, you know, you only get nominated for Engineer of the Year and Album of the Year.
Or you get the certificates to say that you worked on something that won a Grammy.
So I was very lucky, Album of the Year, which means I am in the nomination as well. But yeah, it was crazy, just a demo.
I'm watching you live.
Yeah.
I'm watching you live going, is this going to win?
I remember, sitting there and she keeps winning and winning and winning. And in my head, I'm going, statistically, does this mean I'm more likely to win or less likely to win? Because she keeps going. It's like, how often can you do it? You know, it's like watching Michael Phelps swim.
Yeah.
It's like, does this mean he's going to win them all? Or is this like, is he running out of mojo?
Yeah.
Yeah, but she won. So that was neat. So
I know, I remember watching you go up on stage.
Yeah. I kind of feel like.
And you're literally like 4 inches taller than everybody else, except for Andrew Sheps.
Yeah.
Andrew's about 6'3 and you're 6'5.
He had a much better beard.
Beard. Andrew's beard's like super wide.
Yeah.
And we got the hair.
Yeah.
But I remember. There you are with the full beard. The beard's down about here.
Mine wasn't that long at the time.
Well, maybe here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, I got really lucky. I kind of definitely feel like I was, you know, the kid hanging onto the bumper of a really fast car at that point. Because just to be in the company of those kind of people, all those people who worked on that album, I mean, and it is an amazing album. And I just kind of like snuck one in there, you know. And, you know, to be honest, I have no one to thank more than Dan Wilson and, of course, Adele for being an amazing singer. But Dan Wilson, especially for kind of having that inside of me, like, okay, we're going to make this good. Because he could have easily just said, that's fine. Don't worry about it. It's just a demo. But he, you know, without putting the emphasis or the pressure on anyone to get it good, he steered it in that direction of let's make sure this sounds good just in case kind of thing. So,
which, I, you know, that's the ABR, isn't it? Always be recording.
Yeah.
Just
it really
always
is,
record, always record well, the best you can. And I love that idea of building the tempo map because I agree with that entirely. Remember when we were doing we worked on X Factor together, and when we were doing productions for X Factor, remember what was the first one we did?
What would you do if I sang it to that one? But the Joe Cocker version.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The tempo changes.
Insane.
And with a little help from my friends. Woo.
Yeah, I remember because when you're doing that, I remember you would spend all day down there with the people, right?
Uh-huh.
And
I'd go through with the songs.
Yeah.
I'd sit down with an acoustic guitar and run like 10 songs in 4 hours. And I think I'd do 2 4-hour shifts with 2 different artists during the day. I was down there for 12 hours. So I think we'd have like an hour meeting, an hour lunch, and then whatever. And I'd come back with this sort of short list of songs.
Yeah. And that was, I remember that being one of them. And I think everyone was trying to do that one. And these things are so.
Everybody failed miserably.
Yeah.
What we did was maintain the massive tempo changes.
Yeah, because everything else we were doing, we'd find the tempo, stick to it. Because these, I don't want to say cookie cutter, but they're a bit kind of production factory. Just like, get the song out.
Yeah.
And that was the one that just did not feel right. When we put it to the tempo, trying to get that, it was just like, God, this sucks. And so I remember, you're like, well, what's the original at? And so I looked at it, and I'm like, I can't even tell you. Trying to tap it out. Like, it's nothing. And so we spent the time to tempo map it. And within, I think, 1 bar or 2 bars, it's up 15 BPM from the verse to the chorus. Like, it's crazy. But you don't notice that when you're doing it.
But it's not like tempo. It's like
tempo. Yeah, it's crazy.
Tempo.
And so, we essentially took the blueprint of that tempo. Mm. Made a click track out of it and then recorded a slightly more modern version to that. But ultimately that was what made that song was the tempo.
Yeah. And Simon Cowell really loved it. So
it worked. Yeah.
God bless him.
Bit of a pain, but it worked.
Yeah. That was fantastic. And a fun song to play because whenever we're doing stuff like that, I mean, I'm, you know, like anybody, you open up the computer and you start getting on the Wikipedia and you're like, Jimmy Page plays guitars on this? You're like, yes.
Yeah.
We get to like do a cover and like literally steal, we stole his riffs and everything. It's like, hey, if you're going to do a song with some Jimmy Page, you know. It's like,
yeah, those are fun, those X Factor ones. I mean, I think from a production standpoint, at that point was learning a ton by doing those because we were picking apart other people's songs.
Sure.
And there's something about doing a sound alike or something in the style of where you, even songs you hate. We did some real bad songs, at least ones that I hated, but you learned something from them.
Well, like, the fun thing was, is like Simon Smart, and you know, everybody will leave comments and questions below on their opinion about Simon Cowell. But the thing that I love about Simon, I really, first of all, actually working with him was a very positive experience because he only hires people he likes, not just likes, but thinks will do a good job. So everybody around him is like really talented and just like, how am I here? You know, like sitting there with like all these different like A-list producers and thinking, okay, we're lucky. And, but the thing about him that I love most of all was like, he just didn't want anything obvious. So that one, he wanted the original version. He didn't say that, but he wanted something special, and the special was the original, which luckily we did. But most of the time, he'd come to us with like a Rihanna song and go, I like the Rihanna song, but can you do it country?
Right.
So that was fun.
Yeah, that is really fun. And the nice thing about that from a learning production standpoint is it forces you to figure out the focus of the song, which is something that's often overlooked, I think. You know, people think that all the elements are of equal importance, but really, there's something in there that's driving the song. And that, by doing those kind of crazy covers, we had to figure out, like, okay, we got to do this country, but like, what's the part we can't ditch? And how are we going to keep that in there? And how are we going to make it country and build stuff around it? So there's something about picking apart other people's production, I think, that's an incredibly useful thing to do. Even if you hate the song. Like, I'm not a big fan of pop stuff, top 40, but doing that stuff, you listen to it and you go, that's really good. That's a genius move, you know, and you realize, like, all right, these people know what they're doing. There's something to be learned here.
Another 6415,
Yeah, exactly.
It was great. Well, I mean, so now you're working, what's the school that you're working at?
I'm working at a school called Fusion Academy.
Fusion Academy.
Yeah, it's a private high school, but they have a really modern music program. So they have a recording arts program. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I've transitioned mostly into teaching during the day and still doing production songwriting. In my free time, but I love the teaching aspect of it. So we have a little studio on campus and you got these high school kids coming in. It's a really unique way of approaching a music education. Mm-hmm. And the kind of, the reason it works is because these kids are so good at computers and to them, Pro Tools is Minecraft. When you just tell them that these are little blocks of sound and you just have to arrange them, just arrange them so that they sound good, then all of a sudden production isn't as scary to them. Mm-hmm. There's still so much, you know, we often forget, I think, so much that the average person doesn't know about the recording process. You know, a lot of people still think it's, oh, the band goes into the studio and they play the song and then they leave and it gets on the radio. You know, of course, I wish. But yeah, so
maybe the Who.
Yeah, right. So, you know, I love teaching these kids and it's fun because it's a bit of a backwards approach. They get really good at Pro Tools, but kind of what I do and why I'm there is to teach them the reason why you do that stuff.
Sure.
You know, you can kind of teach anyone how to do this stuff, but like, why are you doing it? And that's the more fun, the more esoteric part is teaching the production and, you know, don't just drag in loops willy-nilly. Mm-hmm. Like, why, what's, let's stop for a second and figure out why this one works and why this one doesn't. So it's fun. I love teaching kids and it's, they're continue to surprise me about how good they can
That's amazing.
Be.
And then of course, we're both good friends with, Billy. Billy Klein was our assistant engineer.
Yeah, he was he my first intern? He might have been at Harmony Studios. Yeah, I think my first and my last. I think he's the only one who kind of went the whole
time.
Yeah, and he's a prime example of, you know, what you should do when you get an internship. I'm like, that guy just worked harder than anybody. Right? You drove up, remember, you drove up for the first few years, drove up from Orange County every time.
Every day,
yeah. It was crazy. Yeah, driving crazy hours,
there,
never complained. Yeah, just did the work. Hung around, got hired on as the second engineer at Harmony and kind of ended up taking over a lot of the sessions so I could come work with you more up at your place. And then opened up a great studio.
So, Hybrid Studios, which we've just featured on the channel and you've been and worked at. We both worked with Robert John on the Rec. Mm-hmm. You did their last, all their live stuff.
Yeah, I did a little live recording there, with video, So, yeah, that's a cool kind of to see how he came in and then ended up being just such a badass.
Yeah, he's such a sweetheart.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, but he was always, you know, the kind of standard that we judged all the other interns.
It's a tough one. I used to have another kid like that. I feel like name checking him because he was a great kid called Dave Lopez, David mm-hmm. Lopez. And I used to arrive every morning, you know, and I work silly hours. I work late, but I also often work early. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so sometimes he'd come in at 9 or 9:30 because I'd be like, oh, we're going to make a deadline, blah, blah, blah. And I didn't know anything about him really out, because at first you get the interns, you're so busy and you're so focused on your work. And I almost feel like I have to apologize to the people I first meet. Like, you know, I really want to say, I will know more about you within 6 months.
Right.
Because we're like so slammed with work and we're trying to get stuff done and we're going to develop a relationship from that. It's just the way it is.
In a weird way.
In a weird roundabout way.
Yeah.
And this guy was, he was about an hour and a half away. Mm-hmm. And he was getting buses. Mm. Yeah. Getting buses. And then remember where Harmony and Swing House used to be, or where Swing House used to be, there's no like bus stop close. So, you know, maybe, you know, he walked like the last mile, but right. he never was late.
Yeah.
I don't know how he got home most of the time.
Yeah. And it makes you, when you get, every once in a while, you get that intern who complains about everything, you just want to be like, you should meet this other guy. Yeah, interning's a tough
I want to say Arthur.
we've had some interesting ones. Yeah. But there's something, I mean, I think really valuable about knowing how to intern. And that was actually something I got from USC, which was really good. We had an internship class, and they kind of prep you for interning. And I think, I mean, there's a lot of young people out there who kind of think, oh, man, all I need is an internship. Just, oh, if I just get an internship, that's the path to success. And, you know, sure, it's a step, but it's not the path. Right. You know, we get a lot of guys who go through a lot of school, and maybe they are very talented, and then they work really hard to get this internship, and then for the first 6 months, all you do is get coffee. Mm-hmm. And as an intern, that's very hard to wrap your head around, because you're like, I'm talented, and I'm driven, and I want, like, give me something to do. And I think I was the same way, interning at Swing House a couple times, kind of being like...
What, you mean like lifting PA equipment in 110 degree weather?
Yeah.
And it was about 110 degrees.
Yeah. And you kind of feel like that. And then I don't think it was until I kind of got in the role of hiring interns that has nothing to do with kind of
you
peacocking. You're not trying to just put people down for the sake of it. A lot of it is, I'm going to give you a menial task to see if you can handle it.
You're a lot gentler on interns than I am.
I always played good cop and you always played bad cop, which worked for us. But still,
we had that one guy up at Spitfire. You gave him a good recommendation. It's lucky he didn't come to me.
Right. Yeah. I always tried to see the best in people. But at the same time, we both know that there were some guys who came in who the reasoning behind it, while you kind of put them through this menial work, is like, if you can't remember to not put mayonnaise on my sandwich, I'm not putting a $35,000 microphone in your hand.
Yeah.
Because you're going to plug it in with the power supply. And, you know, if you can't remember the small stuff, you're not going to do the big stuff. And so as menial as it was, it shows character and it just builds discipline. I mean, there's nothing better than finally getting to get onto Pro Tools, even if it's just to put fades in. Just thinking, God, this is better than getting coffee. So it's, I always recommend to everyone who's going into an internship to watch the documentary Hero Dreams of Sushi. Have you seen it?
I haven't.
Oh, you need to. You'd love it. But it's a guy.
No, I haven't seen it. I know about it, though.
Yeah.
Did you tell me about it?
I might have.
Yeah.
And it's someone, a writer told me about it.
Is the son? Is it the son trying to take over from his father?
I mean, that's a small part of it. It's about the father. It's about Hiro. And he has the world's greatest sushi restaurant. And it's a tiny little place.
Right.
And the whole moral of it, they kind of do this documentary to see, like, what's your secret? How'd you get there? And the kind of, his response is mostly, I always do it. I've been doing this forever. Like, his philosophy is simple food done right. Mm-hmm. And but the part that I like is they're kind of interviewing one of the, you know, the interns who became one of the kind of assistant chefs. And when he first gets started, he's talking about all he do is clean dishes. You just clean dishes, clean dishes, clean dishes. And then when you make it last longer than everyone else, they put you on egg sushi. So egg sushi, I guess, is just egg. It's like scrambled egg, but it's got to be made right. And he was talking about how he made scrambled egg like 1,000 times. And he would make it, and then Hiro would come over, eat it, and then just dump it in the trash. And do it again, give him a little pointer, do it again. And this went on forever. And he said the first time Hiro picked it up and ate it, okay, that's good. He just broke down and crying because it was like the best, the kind of validation of all that work.
Wow.
But that's how, you know, that's his point, is that's how you get to that point. It's not, mm-hmm. you know, you earn it getting up there and you just kind of put the work in. And it's, someone told me about it, this documentary, because we were talking about how I hate documentaries and I hate subtitles. I know, he was like, yeah, watch this thing, Hero Dreams of Sushi. I was like, is it a documentary? Yeah. Is
that and it's good subtitles.
I'm going to hate this. He's like, no, watch it. He's like, it's the best documentary about the music industry you'll ever see. I was like, I thought it was about sushi. He said, no, it is about sushi. But watch it and imagine that the pieces of sushi are songs. And it'll all make sense. And I'm like, you're crazy. Get out of my studio. I buckled down and watched it. And with that in mind, he's right. What he's trying to say is that any craft, like making songs or producing or sushi or woodworking, there's a level of natural ability, yes, but at the same time, the ones who make it are the ones who just put the work in. And right. they're not trying to find that silver bullet. They're not trying to find that crazy out of left field thing that's going to give them instant success. It's, mm-hmm. okay, I got to figure out how to do the simple stuff really, really well. And only after I do that can I move on to the more complicated stuff. Even if I right. think I'm really good, there's something to be said about playing the simple stuff well or making the simple stuff well. And he was right. That was in... After that, I kind of watched who we worked with a little different, mm-hmm. you know, especially session musicians, these guys who, you know, because I always considered myself a really good guitar player, mm-hmm. and I always knew you were a really good guitar player. And you kind of ask yourself, like, why are some of these guys doing sessions and we're not? Like, we'd love to live that lifestyle of just, sure. oh, I'm going to show up, play a couple songs, and head out of here. Right. And kind of looking at these session guys a little bit differently, and the obvious one, Tim Pierce, that we've worked with, mm-hmm. Very eye-opening moment for me was, I mean, sure, he can shred. We've heard him shred. He can play sure. anything under the sun. But I remember at Harmony, I had my Telecaster and my little tweed, Fender tweed, set up. I was probably recording something earlier that day or was just set up for fun or whatever. And I remember Tim walking in. He brought in his million guitars and his amps, and we set them all up. And he, oh, what's that? Oh, that's my Telecaster. Fires it on, rolls up the volume, and just plays an open E chord. And just knowing that he didn't touch anything on the amp, and it was just plugged straight in the same way I play it, but that open E chord coming out of that amp was the most beautiful sound I ever heard. And it's not like a chord I couldn't play.
Right.
You know, he's not doing anything special, but he just played it. And I just remember thinking to myself, I need to stop complaining about my gear. You know, and right. and he just plays everything so simple. But it just sounds better. Mm-hmm. Like, you and I could pick up a guitar and play the exact same notes he did, but he plays it better than everyone.
Yeah.
And to me, that's what, you know, that's Hiro. You know, anyone can cut a piece of fish and put it on a piece of rice, but he just does it better.
Yeah.
Because he's done it a million times. Mm-hmm. And taking that kind of, like, it's a little bit of a self-check of, wow, I'm not as good of a guitar player as I thought. Because, sure, I can shred and I can figure out a solo note for note, but can I really play a simple chord progression well? Like, can I mm-hmm. put it in there and make it sound good? And I think I changed the way I play a little bit after that. And, you know, just watching session musicians do it was very eye-opening.
Yeah, Tim, I've had those moments many times with Tim. But I do remember, I hadn't been in LA that long, and I was making a record with a country artist that was on, I can't remember the name of the artist. They were on a soap, mm-hmm. on one of those daytime soaps, Jean Restless or something, and they were right. doing a country record. And I'm fresh off the boat. In fact, it was ADATS. We had ADATS and we had, remember that Mackie console that was digital?
Yeah.
And you could automate the EQs to morph and do all this kind of stuff.
Yeah.
So digital Mackie console and ADATS. And James Burton comes in to play guitar.
Mm.
So firstly, I'm like, right. I'm like
a hero. Yeah.
Like James Burton. I have like a little Fender Deluxe set out there. And I've got it set like at 3 or whatever, and he strums it his Telecaster, and he's like, and I was like, what did they do wrong? And like, he goes out there and he's like, turns it down to 0, and then moves it like I don't even think it got close to 1,
right.
just like moved it, and it was just cleaner, like no distortion, no crunch, nothing to thicken up the tone, just the cleanest sound I've ever heard. So like a bit more gain on the Mackie,
right,
on the digital Mackie, and so. He's like, you know, let's hear the song. I'm not going to do a bad I can, but I'm not going to do the bad Southern accent because I'm not very good at it, obviously. And so I go into record at the top of the song. He's like, you put me in record like that. So I was like, okay, we'll put you in record. Yeah. And he's sort of like, the song starts and he's like picking, like playing some arpeggio stuff. And the chorus comes in, he just plays little digs in a little deeper, and plays a little bends and stuff like that. And I'm like, oh, wow, great. You know, comes up to the bridge and it's obviously a solo, mm-hmm. like a solo section. And he then proceeds to play the whole chorus melody that he's only heard twice mm-hmm. back, like immediately, mm-hmm. and plays a solo within the chorus melody,
right.
comes out, finishes the song. And of course, I'm mm-hmm. remembering it. All my hair's like kind of standing on end and I'm looking at him. And he goes, could I have a chord chart? And I'm just like...
For a souvenir? Like, what?
Yeah, could you want to sign it and put it up on the wall? I mean, like, why do you need a chord chart? You just played the whole song by ear, went to the solo, played the chorus melody, and then embellished it. Mm-hmm. And I'm just like, that was, for me, was the big lesson about, because, you know, I can out-technical almost any guitar player. I can sweep pick, I can shred, I learned the Holdsworth left-hand legato and the right, and I love all this stuff. But what I did is I didn't do it in a balanced way. Mm-hmm. I was all like the technique, and then my ear was here. This was growing, my technique, and my ear was growing like this.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And it made me like,
back to square one.
Back to square one.
Yeah. That's my own little hand model that I have here that I've always thought about. Because I used to shred in high school. I was shredder, you know, McGee, just 80s rock all the time. Still a little bit, but after hearing people do simple stuff really well and kind of rethinking how I learn, kind of realizing that, yes, you still need to practice, you still need to get good, you need to work on the things you suck at, but what makes you good is, I used to play, if my skill level was right here, I used to try to play everything here, mm-hmm. right at the edge of my skill level, which I could do, but it never sounded right. Because you're always kind of just hanging on by your fingertips. Mm-hmm. And so the kind of analogy that I made from that was like, I need to get my skill level up here and play here. And the only reason why I should ever make this skill level go up is to make this come up. I should never be playing up at the top of my thing. I need to play, everything should seem easy to me, and I should always play what's easy so that it sounds good. I don't care if I can sweep and tap and playing behind my head and light it on fire and do a dance. You know, like, can I play that chord? And it's not just about practicing that one chord over and over. It's about getting good at the instrument so that doesn't seem like anything. It's like when you watch professional athletes do stuff that seems impossible. And it's like, no, I just do this all day.
Yeah.
You know? So that was the reasoning now. I used to try to get good so that I could play up here. But now I just try to get better so that I can still play down here, but better.
Yeah.
I just want my easy stuff to sound better. And I think that was a big turning point for me in terms of production and making stuff sound good.
Right.
Because I think we put so much emphasis on the technical. Oh, my guitar doesn't sound good.
Sure.
Okay, well, let me Google miking techniques. You're sitting there in your bedroom at 4 a.m. trying to get that distant mic to sound good. Mm-hmm. Oh, no, it still doesn't. I still don't sound like Hendrix. must be using the wrong mic. Yeah. So it's good to know all that stuff. But yeah, it really just came down to rethinking how I play and really rethinking what instruments do in the song. I remember a very striking moment. You probably don't remember this. One of the first sessions I did with you, I think it was Vedera maybe. I remember like one of our first studio days together. And I knew you shred. And you knew I shred. And we're both kind of shreddy guitarists. And we had spent some time jamming and just like going mm-hmm. bluesy till 4 a.m.
That didn't happen, wife. Kasha, that didn't happen.
We were working hard.
Yeah. We were working hard, yeah. I think you and I, just as a tangent, did the unfortunate thing of shredding till 4 a.m. and posting it online.
Oh, yeah, that was a mistake.
At like 4 a.m.
Having fun. Are you having fun?
Yeah.
Come home.
Cash is like, come home.
Yeah. But I remember thinking like, this was like the first time you're working with a band, and you plugged in a guitar to do a track, right? Mm-hmm. And you're like, okay, I just want to overdub something here. It was kind of already done, but you wanted to put something on. And plugged in the guitar and in the back of mine and thinking, here comes the shred. Can't wait to hear what you do. And you kind of warmed up, doing all this stuff. And I remember, here comes the click, here it comes, and you just droned an open E. Maybe went up to the third. Still drowning that opening. Oh, no, back to the E. Okay. I just remember thinking, seriously? That's it? And kind of thinking, that was a big letdown. And then later, on playback, maybe after we overdubbed a couple more things, listening to the chorus and hearing that drone and being like, oh, that's really good. That's actually the perfect part.
I probably started from Tim.
Probably. I hadn't met Tim at that point, so now thinking back, yeah, that's a very Tim Pierce thing
maybe
to do.
WWTD, what would Tim do?
Yeah, exactly.
What would Tim do?
But yeah, I just remember thinking like, okay, he can shred, but he didn't, and thinking, I would have never thought to put that on there. And right. Kind of that leading to me stopping the way I look at instruments as instruments and as right. Just, they're just noisemakers. That's not an electric guitar, that's just a noisemaker. It's not sure. A snare drum, it's just a noisemaker. You don't have to hit the center of that snare drum. You right. Can hit any part of it. You know, you can, any of these things just make noise, and ultimately with the way you want to think is not, here's my electric guitar, what electric guitar part am I going to put on this to make sure. People go, cool electric guitar. You look at your song and say, what's missing? Mm-hmm. And what do I have at my disposal? I have an electric guitar. How am I going to get what's missing out of that instrument? And that's another kind of way of looking at it. And maybe it's just an open E. Maybe that's all you need. Right. Just thinking in terms of frequencies and width and depth and things like that. What hole do I need to fill? And how am I going to get this thing to fill it?
I always think you're touching on a good point there. Beyond the even the parts, I always think of Brian Wilson's production. Mm. Because when you listen to the Beach Boys stuff, like you listen to Pet Sounds and stuff, he just would choose these instruments in certain frequency ranges. Mm-hmm. And they were on four tracks.
Yeah.
You know, and so it would be like, oh, I'm going to have a ding, a grang, and a grang, and a bull. And yeah. It would just be like, and everything just completely fits together. Like mm-hmm. He just chose the right instruments to work together. It always seems like, maybe naively to me, it seemed like he knew exactly where everything was going to be placed, so it just mixed itself.
Right.
I mean, now that's not to say that, you know, he didn't sit there with the engineer and create the most amazing mixes. Of course he did. But his production is still, I think, the best production, probably some of the best production ever outside yeah. of, you know, outside of some of the Beatles stuff. But even then, for me, it was like, I love the Doors production. Mm-hmm. I love Bruce Botnick's engineering. I love the fact that the drums just sound perfectly in phase.
Yeah.
And yet you're like, this is the 60s.
Right.
It sounds like it was recorded yesterday. But no, Brian Wilson had that ability to just choose instruments and place them in the audio spectrum. So they just sat together.
Yeah.
Because they didn't have like semi-parametric graphic bars,
right.
Mid-sweep, linear phase, blah-de-blah-blahs. They had like Poltech EQs.
Yeah, and old radio equipment.
Yeah.
Retrofitted into a studio.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, it is.
And it's so you have to choose the instrument.
Yeah, and it's and that's an interesting way to look at it, is placing that in there. A lot of times when people ask me, when my students ask me, like, because one of the big questions that comes up, and I'm sure you've heard it before, is, what's a producer? Oh, you're a producer? What's a producer? To someone who doesn't do music.
Sure.
And you kind of have to explain to them, like,
yeah.
You tell me. Right? It can be so many roles. And one of the ways I try to explain it to people is, well, one, it's kind of the dumb answer is, like, the way a coach is to a basketball team, a producer sure. is to a record. You know, you're not the one out there playing, but you're utilizing the talent in the best way possible.
Right.
So that's kind of the short answer. To people who maybe know music a little more, who have done this, who are struggling with production and ask me what a producer is, there's a really weird way of thinking about it, but it falls in line with what you're saying with like how Brian Wilson places stuff. I always try to imagine it that a producer's role, like if the producer is part of the band, his or her instrument is silence, right? So everyone sure. else is making their drum noise, their guitar noise, their bass noise. It's the producer's job to figure out where the silence goes. And that mm-hmm. has to do with placing all the instruments. Mm-hmm. And you know, what we often hear is the term overproduction, which really doesn't mean anything.
No.
Is often just, I always think of like, you didn't put enough silence in there.
Sure.
You know, there's nowhere to hear everything because everything's stepping all over everything else. Mm-hmm. And that could mean many different things. Silence could mean, and this is something I picked up from you, watching you, the way you made records. A lot of times we would record so much. And then after the artist left, you would just sit there and just start muting stuff. Hit play and go, God, no, nope, that needs to be out. That needs to be out. That shouldn't be there. That shouldn't be there. But it's a lot like, we just put all that work into it. What are you doing?
Yeah.
And then it's the big picture of right. like, that's getting in the way. And right. I don't need that there. And silence could mean muting an entire part. Right. Silence could mean the silence between hi-hat hits. Like, you know, one of the things we do is this going to be an eighth note pattern or 16th note pattern? And really all that is what's the silence between those notes? Right. Silence could mean the space between two notes on a chord. You know, we know that...
I'm looking for something. Keep going.
We know that you don't always need to play all six notes on a guitar in a chord. In fact, a lot of times that's a horrible idea. This is another what would Tim Pierce do kind of thing.
Yep.
And that the distance between the root and the third and the distance between the root and the tenth is a very different thing, even though the same technically two notes. But if you listen to any Chili Peppers record, we all know that root tenth sounds a lot better than root third.
What's this? I just posted this today.
Oh, okay. The music is not in the notes, but in the sounds. There you go. Yeah. He said it a lot better than I did. Mozart guy.
Mozart said this. I just posted it on... You'll be able to date when we did this. It's, and it says, the music is not in the notes, but in the silence between. Mm-hmm. Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart.
And I think that's a sign of good production and what I always aim to do, learning from you and learning from guys like Dan Wilson and Fraser T. Smith, who I think Fraser T. Smith is one of the best producers at silence. I mean, that guy, there's so much space in his records. You can hear it in the Adele stuff he did.
Sure.
I mean... Watching him work was really incredible. He's minimalist.
Talk about a sweetheart and a classy human being.
And an incredible musician, my God. But he just knows what not to play. Like, that's his strength. I could just watch him sit just on a drum machine. Okay, that's good. All right, we went through all that trouble for that. And then when you hear it, you're like, oh, God, it's genius. That's really good. So I think that's one of the tougher things, especially when you get good at this stuff, because you want to put the notes in there.
I use this analogy a lot, so everybody that knows me is going to glaze over on this one, but I always say pretty much anything in life is like dressing like a hipster. Everybody's like, what I mean by that is like the hipster has got the kind of like the cool, ironic t-shirt that looks like, oh yeah, I was just driving, you know, home the other morning, and there was this garage sale, and I just pulled up, and it just happened to be this like late 40s Disneyland t-shirt with this strategic rip, you know. But you know that they went to a store on Melrose and paid $275 for it. But it's just like, And then there's that sort of like just the way, I mean, I have bad hair, I'm famous for it. But you know, that kind of like just the look that looks like that you just kind of woke up, and it's really cool the way it kind of just happens to be laying off to the side.
Right.
And that's really what we do. Sometimes we spend, you just said it perfectly with Fraser T. Sometimes it's like you spend a long time not doing anything, just figuring out what to do. So it just sounds like you just relaxed, just went, oh yeah, ka-ding, ka-ching, ka-ding, you know.
Yeah.
Start dressing like a hipster. You just, it takes a long time to make it look like you didn't do anything.
Yeah,
but it just happened to be really cool.
You're not trying to be flashy. Me, this little thing.
Oh, this little thing.
It's okay. It's cool. Yeah. It's whatever. Yeah. It's true. That's what we do. But yeah, production-wise, I think that's what I aim for. And, you know, I always think it's funny. As an engineer, the only reason I got good as an engineer was by learning how to fix stuff that sucks. What's to say? You learn how to polish turds, which is kind of what we do. But you get really good at it.
Right.
But you don't become a good producer until you work with good people. And I didn't even consider myself a producer until years of being in the same room with the Warren Hewarts and the Dan Wilsons and the Fraser T's kind of thing, and just being a fly on the wall and realizing that my idea of what production is was backwards, just completely backwards. And, you know, even working with producers who I didn't like their music, pop producers who I just never listened to their artists, didn't care for them, there's always something to learn from.
I agree.
Even if I thought they were relatively talentless, actually, there's always something to learn from, even if it's how not to do something. You can learn from that. And I used to, I mean, you knew the kind of sessions I used to do, but there's always walked away from and tried to be like, okay, I learned something today. It took me 14 hours, but I learned a little thing here and there. There's something, you can learn something from everything.
No, you can. Yeah. It's the situations, you know. I mean, I remember you were telling me horror stories about producers, like humiliating artists, and guys walking out on artists and stuff like that, and just, you know, acting like it's about them.
Yeah.
And we know it's not about us. I mean, all this joking aside, is like, it's our job to capture a great performance, encourage the artist, you know, do all of these things that got absolutely nothing to do with us.
Yeah. And it's, you can know everything in the world about everything, but if you can't convince a person to go into the booth and sing, you're not going to get the job done.
Yeah.
And so that was another rude awakening that, wow, there's a lot of people skills involved with this, which is rough for me because I generally hate most people. I just put up with them. But that was a lot, especially vocal producing. That was one thing I thought was interesting. Some people would come in who are amazing singers to vocal produce, and they could not vocal produce. Sure. Vocal producing was not, let me sing to you what you should sing, and you do that.
I'm not going to say who it is because it's, but we both know that this one particular writer producer is one of the biggest writer producers out there. And great guy, incredibly talented. And I would do vocal production with him.
Mm-hmm.
And all his thing was he would try to get the singer to sing his runs.
Right. Yeah.
But there were runs that were natural to him. So it's like, oh, whatever the run was, you know, the hand and all that stuff. And the problem is it was, you could do 15 different kinds of runs to get from the high A, you know, to the low A, you know, one or two octaves. And you could go around the arpeggio, you could arpeggiate it. You could do a sixth or a seventh, a minor step, whatever he wanted to do, all these different things. But the point is, that was his natural thing. Mm. So then he was trying to get the singer to copy him.
Right.
And I learned that pretty quickly. I remember thinking to myself, yeah, but, you know, their run is different to yours, but it's just as cool and it suits their voice better.
Right.
So we would like go in these little rabbit holes of spend like 20 minutes working on a run. Meanwhile, you know, we should really be working on getting an amazing vocal performance, but it's just the one piece on the bridge and it has to be, oh, ew, you know, and it's just like.
Yeah, it's a tough thing. I think just vocal production, but even just production.
Sure.
It's not, you know, about going in there and showing them, why can't you play like me, kind of thing.
Sure.
You know, a lot of it is just kind of making them comfortable. I think that's what it comes down to, just getting the best performance out of it and learning that you don't have to be a great musician to be a great producer. In fact, sometimes that's the worst thing you can be, is a great musician to be a great producer.
Sure.
And in terms of songwriting as well.
Yep.
You know, they really do step on each other's toes quite often.
Yeah, Tom Petty, remember, said that, what was his quote? If he'd been a great guitar player, it wouldn't have been a good songwriter.
Yeah, and I was watching this, I should send you the link, a great interview with Michael Jackson about how he would write songs. And they're talking about writing Billie Jean, and he's sang the little riff. He's like, I had the riff in my head, you know, and he somehow sings the bass line, does the drum part, and the strings all with his mouth at once. It's crazy. And then the interviewer asks him, okay, but what after that? How do you build the track? What do you decide the instruments do? And all he said was, you know what? Get out of the way of the song. He said, a lot of times the musicians get in the way of the song. Just get out of the way of the song. Mm-hmm. It'll figure itself out. And it's very like, oh yeah, it does. Like, stop trying to write that part. Like, just make it comfortable. And I learned vocal production predominantly by doing sessions with you. And neither you nor I are great singers. We're not making albums anytime, solo records anytime soon.
I don't know. You want to hear my rap album? It's pretty...
I'm sure it's as good as my rap album. But you could go a whole vocal session without singing to the artist.
Sure.
You don't need to sing to them. You just need to kind of steer them in the right direction. And sometimes it's just, you just need to talk about anything other than singing.
I mean, you know that's one of my biggest things.
Yeah.
Look, working with our good friend Dave, you know, he gets into his own head.
Yeah.
And he pushed the boundaries with me and like getting great vocal performances. And then I think after we did vocals of him, maybe two or three songs, I realized he was the poster child for distraction.
Mm.
So all we started to do was just joke about everything and not talk about singing.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when we got all the best vocals.
Yeah.
Because he's incredibly talented, you know, insanely talented.
Yeah.
But as soon as he gets into his own mind about the song, oh, we could be on a, I mean, we could be on a word, not a verse.
Not even a word.
Yeah, like, a piece of a word. Yeah, a syllable for like 20 minutes.
Yeah.
And I remember he had us go back and fix a word. And he's like, don't you hear that, as opposed to,
I do remember that exact moment.
Yeah.
And there was just some silence between you and I. Oh, yeah. You're right. Let's go with the second one. Yeah. It was. Yeah. And it wasn't about being a great singer. It was just about kind of like, what do we need to do to get this track done?
Yeah. What we need to do. And, you know, I've even more these days in my life, you know, I think of that analogy about marriage or where they say, what was it? Would you rather be happy or right?
Mm-hmm.
When it comes to like, you know, with your wife comes to you or your girlfriend and says, blah, 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 blah. And you're like, in the back of your mind, like, that didn't happen. That's not what happened. But then you're like, sure, honey.
Yeah.
You know, as I've grown older, I've realized that all relationships are the same.
Mm-hmm.
And there's nothing more complicated for us if we try to be different people with different people.
Mm.
Like, yeah. If I'm different to you than I am to Connor, to Justin, to Morgan, I have to be just the same. Look, if I'm kind of grumpy, I'm kind of grumpy of everybody. If I'm happy, I'm happy. I'm not trying to like act like something else, because then you portray all these different relationships with different people, and it's really confusing.
Yeah.
And so I found that with singers and stuff like that, and I know you know this, but it's worth reiterating. I've said it 1,000 times, but I'll say it again. Just if they have a problem with something, even if you don't know what they're talking about, I always just go, you know what? Go and re-sing it. And I don't mean like passive aggressive. I mean, I honestly know now, it's not a passive aggressive thing. I know that it's so much easier to spend 10 minutes re-singing the verse,
mm-hmm.
than it is to discuss it, re-comp it, retune it,
tell
them that they're wrong. You know, you can literally spend 3 hours doing nothing. I did a record, a very big famous record, where there was so much infighting on this one song. I mean, and I just got to this point of like, there's two very different ideas of what this song should be.
Mm-hmm.
The amount of days we have wasted on this, we could have cut both versions and finished them, had them mixed by now.
Yeah.
And then in 2 months' time, when we're mastering the record, they could decide which version to use.
Right.
It's that, it sometimes, like you're saying, as the engineer, when you're watching the production stuff going on, that's when you can learn so much.
Oh, yeah.
Because you can just...
Psychology class.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then, you know, for me, I'm doing too much talking here, but for me, like, we're working with Jack Douglas, and you work with Jack as mm-hmm. well, is his style of production is unique again, because everybody involved in the project is really important.
Right.
You know, and that's why he's had such long-term relationships. We're working with Aerosmith. He's managed to work with them in, like, 1973 and 2012, whatever it was, because... You know, Tom Hamilton and Brad Whitford and Joey are just as important as Joe and Steven.
Right.
That there's no, doesn't play favorites,
mm-hmm.
makes everybody, so he creates band records. When he makes a record with them, everybody goes, that sounds like the band. Mm-hmm. That sounds like Aerosmith.
Totally, you know? Yeah.
And that's a unique, that's actually quite unique.
Yeah.
His skill set is, I've only worked with a couple of people that even touch on that, let alone have it entirely.
Yeah.
Most producers I work with as engineers identify the talent and then focus on it and kind of alienate members of the band.
Mm-hmm.
I've worked on albums where I've seen band members quit, leave, whatever.
Yeah.
But then I worked with Dave Jordan as a musician, and I came in last into the band and just kind of felt like I had to keep quiet, and he made me feel so important in mm-hmm. that session.
Mm-hmm.
And that was eye-opening, especially when you're a musician and you see how a producer produces you.
Right.
And I remember him telling me that he had never fired a band member or replaced a guy's part with somebody else in his whole career, except on one album where they came to mix and they just realized they had to recut the drums.
Mm-hmm.
But in all of those 40-plus platinum records that he made in his career, never had a... Johnny Midnight, never replayed stuff, never got anything.
Right.
He prided himself on getting performances out of musicians.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, that's where it comes in, being a coach, you know?
Yeah.
Crappy team in the hands of a good coach is probably going to go pretty far.
Yeah.
So.
It's been borne out so much.
Yeah. It's crazy.
Great coach. And, you know, like, I know you don't follow soccer, but this team that just won the Premier League in England was the team that was almost relegated last season.
Nice.
With almost exactly the same players.
Really?
Yeah.
Different coach?
Well, Ranier came in, this classic coach with years of experience playing, you know, coaching on the court, just came in and they went from that they were 3,000-1
mm-hmm.
to win the league.
Crazy.
And a handful of people put a bet on it, and they're all like stupid rich.
Yes, please.
So yes, you're very right about that. A great coach can turn things around. So look, this has been wonderful.
Indeed.
You know, of course, I you know, full disclosure, Phil is the godfather to my daughter.
Yep, that was a big mistake.
So, yeah, it's great. It's great to be able to talk about this. And we had a blast today.
Yeah.
You did all the work. Kind of filmed it.
I wouldn't say that. Morgan did most of the work.
Right.
Well, sit here and click buttons.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you did the bit that I would normally do, which is great. So I got to sit on the couch and do thousands of emails.
Yay.
Woo. Fun stuff.
Yeah. So, yeah, it was fun. So hopefully you guys get to hear the record. It's going to be great.
Yeah, it's going to be awesome. Thanks a lot, mate.
Of course.
Please, as ever, leave loads of questions and comments below. Go to Produce Like a Pro, check out the website. There's a whole bunch of stuff to download for free. Try the 14-day free trial and all that wonderful stuff. So have a marvelous time recording and mixing. Thanks.